Hey there, this is your orchestration tutor, Thomas Goss, coming to you from Orchestration Online Central here in downtown Wellington. It's a really beautiful, actually not that beautiful of a day. It's kind of rainy right now. Yeah, but still gorgeous. It's always gorgeous here. I don't care what the weather is like. It's just really terrific. Wonderful to be here. And yeah, so this is my sort of makeup party for the fact that, you know, sort of to make up for the fact that I kind of blew it last Sunday when we were trying to have this live event. And as some of you might remember, I just couldn't get the controls for my broadcasting application to work. So anyhow, this is my way of making up for it so that you guys can watch those three tips and hear about some of the things that I was that I wanted to talk about. And just, you know, to have a chance to reach out to you guys and to thank you. And I'll get into that in a minute. You know, why I owe you guys some gratitude. But anyhow, what I'd like to start with is just to talk to you about what I've done this year and how that relates to everything, and introduce you to my cat. Oh, he's big. This is Franklin, right here. He is a composer's cat. Say hello to the people. And he might be bothering me as I try to talk to you guys. So yeah, so what did I do in 2014? So as you can see, it's been pretty varied for me this year. I actually really liked that last bit with Sofia Urvayeva playing my bravura variations on an old biker rock song. Of course, as you saw, my work as the education composer in residence for Orchestra Wellington. I've actually done, two shows already. I presented both of them. It was really kind of cool. And we also did that education concert in the schools with brass and percussion. And yeah, I mean, just really awesome work. I was just really happy to work with them again this year. And then, as you saw as well, just briefly, you know, working on a film score as the orchestrator with Dmitry Rybnikov. That was really cool. Of course, that that job came like right on top of all this other stuff. It's kind of funny. I had just finished working on Baby Pops and some other stuff, and I had this little window of opportunity in which to finish the Mac Pro Video orchestration course. So I took the time off, and you know, I gave myself about 6 weeks to finish it. And as I was going along, I thought, okay, this is also going to be the only chance I'm going to get to complete that to complete that website that I wanted to do all along. And so I did that, and then some other stuff started coming up, and I had to take care of that. And then finally, Dmitry came along and said, "Hey, I need you to orchestrate this for me, please, desperately. You know, is there any way you can fit this in?" it sort of became like this Far Side cartoon. So I did that, and I've also done a lot of crossover work this year. Of course, you might remember the Mission Estate concert, that clip back there, When You Say Nothing at All. That was kind of fun to do. So I think I scored about 55 to 60% of the orchestrations. That was really cool. And it was really cool working with Chong Lim. He's a really awesome music director. It was just an honor to work with somebody at that level, and to just be able to have the confidence to put it out there. And of course, recently I've done some work with the Shillong Chamber Choir. Also a bunch of really righteous people doing music in an out of the way corner of the world, but who should be recognized in their own country, which has, you know, got a massive market for music, and maybe the rest of East Asia and the world, hopefully. So that's what I've done this year. And, I'm not just saying all this stuff to just say like, hey, you know, look at all the stuff I did. Aren't I cool? That's not it at all. The reason why I'm talking about it is because I want you guys to get a sense of what it's like to work at this level. If you are, if you are a student or a semi-professional and you are, you know, kind of building up your career as an orchestrator or as a composer, yeah, this is the sense of how it's going to go. You know, you are going to have to work quickly. You're going to have to develop a really varied client base. You're going to have to find that string on your fiddle that really, really sounds, and you're going to have to play it for all that it's worth and put a lot of into it and find creative new ways to use what that strength is that you've got. That's what I'm trying to say with this. And also, here comes my gratitude to you, and that is for keeping me sane this year. Of course, my family did that as well, but it's, you know, whenever I was working on something and was just completely just out of my mind with distraction over this or just annoyance at that or some dumb issue came up or somebody was being a jerk. Which doesn't happen too often, but it does happen. It was just really nice to go to the Facebook page or to go to YouTube and read the comments, and to just to have a give and take with this community. That's meant a lot to me. Okay, I think that is something that's really important for us as colleagues. Is we need to be able to relate to each other. And we need to be able to say those things to each other that only we can understand. Right, guys? Right, everybody? Okay, so I'm going to shut up now, and I'm going to show you the first tip that I was going to show at the party back on Sunday. Okay, so hope you enjoy it, and I'll have a few words to say. There's something that I realized I didn't state very clearly, So I'm going to clarify that at the end of the tip, okay? So here goes.
Niente is an incredibly alluring musical effect. The concept of starting a note, as it were, from nothing, and then gradually insinuating it into the listener's consciousness little by little, or the opposite, dwindling away until the ear isn't even sure if it can hear that same note anymore. Unfortunately for many developing orchestrators, it's one of those markings that's like a $10 word that someone picked up in a vocabulary course, and now works into every sentence possible. Composers sprinkle it into their scores with abandon, assigning it to any instrument, any passage, and then assuming the musician will work it out. The outcome of this is that many musicians will look at the marking as a sign of naivety, or simply ignore it and play something more practical, deciding what they think is best for you. While this may certainly save your score, it's the exact opposite of the concept of craft. What's needed here is for orchestrators to have a deeper understanding of what niente really means, what it sounds like, and what instruments can truly achieve it. Then the effect can be used with much greater accuracy and judiciousness, and perhaps we can rebuild a bit more trust with the players as well. First of all, let's define the word. Niente literally means nothing. Musically speaking, that translates as a tone which seems to have no attack or release, and very little to excite sound waves if it's a sustained tone. Have you ever noticed at a social gathering that there are some people who know how to speak quite softly, and still others who seem physically incapable of toning it down? This latter category of person is often built for the task of whooping it up large, both psychologically and physiologically. Even in a private moment, they may have to work hard not to be heard. That is exactly how the orchestra works. There are some instruments that are quite discreet, capable of incredible subtlety, while others are intentionally built for projection and volume. Understanding why that is goes to the very root of the concept of tone creation and is fundamental knowledge for orchestrators. Know this, and you'll never misuse niente again. Let's take the oboe to begin with. While it's certainly not the loudest of instruments, all the same it's incapable of a true niente attack or release. In fact, that kind of playing is antithetical to the way that oboists try to play. As is typical with wind instruments, the oboist initiates the attack of the note by tonguing the front of the hard palate, right behind their upper front teeth. This tiny jolt is what's required to start the vibration of the double reeds. Without it, there's very little control or precision. This is true for bassoonists as well, who work very carefully on a clear, well-defined attack that breathes life and meaning into each tone. And in fact, it's the general goal of wind players to carefully shape their notes. This is something that's not instinctive to the average composer who comes from a piano background, where pressing a key makes a hammer strike a string, and then releasing cuts the sound off almost immediately. Instead of this, wind players strive for clear enunciation at the start of an ordinary note, followed by a sustain with an excellent quality of tone, and then finishing with a nicely rounded cutoff, so that the sound comes to a natural-sounding end. The last thing a player wants to do is to fizzle out or suddenly end, unless the music is specifically composed that way. Brass instruments have the same general aesthetic about the shapes of tones, and they have to be just as precise and clear in their attack as oboes and bassoons. They can't just gradually start a note from out of nothing. That's not the way that it works. Nevertheless, double reeds and brass are capable of playing extremely softly. If you mean triple pianissimo for these instruments, then simply mark it as such, and you'll get very delicate, distant tones. But they won't be niente by any means, because these instruments simply don't work that way. What instruments can play niente? To answer that question, please stick around when we come back to this question later on in today's video.
Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed that first half of that tip. Of course, I'm sure most of you realize what can play niente, and we'll talk about that, we'll revisit that in a minute. But something I want to clarify about that is that brass instruments have an exercise where they start from nothing, and they excite a tone in their embouchure just using their diaphragm. Okay, so they just like, they just kind of go, sorry, I can't do it. And so it doesn't involve any you know, it's, they're not going, you know, they're not really going. It's something that really gradually, slowly comes from their breathing, but that's not niente. Okay. There are some players who can do one, you know, who can like really just very, very carefully just get, just barely get a tone, and they just, and just come from triple P. That is not the the common technique of orchestral brass. Okay, so, you know, that's not something you can really expect from players exactly. So that's why brass is just not really the best thing for niente. And same thing with oboe. I mean, I think that there are some oboists who can do that, who can just start with, you know, diaphragmatically create a tone from their reeds. I might be wrong about this, but I think it is possible. But that is also not niente, because when the reed starts to speak, it is not, you know, quadruple P, okay? It is like, you know, maybe triple P, maybe double P, but it's, you know, but that quality, which we're going to talk about in the second half of the video, is not the same thing. It is not at all. So see, the thing about this is expectation, okay? You are expecting that everybody is going to sound like almost nothing, okay? That's what you want, right? Okay, so you've got to, as the, you know, having craft as an orchestrator, you've got to realistically know who can do that, right? And not just say, well, you know, this is what I want. I want the oboes to do it too, and I want the brass to do it too, because I sort of heard somebody do that once. You know, that's not good enough, okay? I mean, you have to really know who can really go down to almost nothing and come from nothing and go right back down to it, okay? That's really important. Okay, so now let's focus on some questions here, okay? I've got a couple of really good ones that were, I sort of saved from people requesting on the website. Hang on. So, apologies, I did not save the name of the person who asked this first question. Okay, but it is a pretty good one. It asks, is it common practice for composers to indicate harp pedal changes every time a pedal is changed? If so, how far in advance do harp players like to see pedal changes indicated? That's a pretty good question, and I think I answered most of those questions in my tip, actually, speaking of tips, which we're going to talk about in a bit. Just briefly, the harp players like to see it before it happens. Usually like maybe the bar before or a few beats before. And then of course, when there is a specific section of the music that starts with a specific tuning, then that tuning should be marked at the beginning of the section. Like if there's a big tacit where nobody's playing, and then there's a rehearsal mark where the music starts, that rehearsal mark should have a pedal diagram so that the harpist knows how to set their instrument. Because, of course, the conductor is going to be saying, okay, everybody go back to this, you know, this figure, to this rehearsal mark, and the harpist is going to have to really hurriedly change her pedals. Okay. So I would say, like, the bar before or a couple of beats before. And if it's music where the pedals are changing a lot, then you just have to, you know, if you play an E-flat at the beginning of the bar and then there's, like, a E-natural or an E-sharp coming up, then you just have to put it, you know, in a place where they can read it and change the pedal, okay? So that's the... And that's actually one of the strong arguments for not having harp music that constantly changes all the time, because, you know, then you're basically turning your harpist into a tap dancer. Okay, next question. This is from Connor Helms. He asks, how can I most professionally approach potential ensembles and local/community orchestras? And then he goes into this a little bit, and he says, every chance I've had, for large orchestral performances from private orchestras, I can't get grants or the money together. They like my work and are impressed with my engraving and professionalism overall, but I can't raise the money. If I can't raise the money, I don't get the performance. Okay, so look, that is just, you know, where you are at. You have to just live with it and find opportunities, because they don't just happen on their own. You have to just keep trying and keep trying. And I know that just sounds like a pat answer, and I apologize, but it is really the truth. One thing that you can do is get more closely involved with the groups that you want to perform your works. Like, I once had a chamber ensemble that was composed of my friends, and my friends all happened to be playing for some of the top orchestras in the region. So we had this piano quartet, and it was really great. It was fantastic. The cellist was from the San Francisco Opera Orchestra, and the viola player was like principal viola for, you know, most of the regionals in the San Francisco Bay Area, and the violinist was one of these rotating concertmaster type guys. You know, always gets hired to be the concertmaster whenever a big show comes into town. So they were all really good. I mean, I was like the fumbling nitwit in that group as the pianist, but that was something that I did, and I just found it really rewarding, and it really showed me what those players were going through to get my music out there. And so, you know, we did a few gigs together, and that was really, really fun. That was one way that I was able to get more of a community around my music, because these players also, you know, they weren't the decision makers about who got performed and who didn't, but they were, you know, they were part of a social network of performers and musicians and people in the arts that built a fabric around my career. Okay, so that was one way. And it was an example of me rolling up my sleeves. Another one was working a lot as, you know, as contributing original music and arrangements to student groups. I did that a lot when I first started out my career. And of course, I eventually worked with the Santa Rosa Symphony Young People's Chamber Orchestra, which was really fantastic. That was led by my friend, the viola player. And those were all like semi-virtuosic teenagers. And, you know, they were just really dedicated to their music. That was just complete luck. And I composed about 15 works for them. But I do have to say that you know, even though I was really active in that scene, I was limited by the circumstances. You know, trying to get involved or, you know, get in touch even with the orchestra, you know, the conductor of the orchestra whose education programs I was helping, you know, totally did not want to talk to me, have anything to do with me. Didn't answer any of my emails or notes or anything like that. Just didn't have the time for it. And, you know, I respect that. I don't resent it. I'm not out there saying, oh, man, this guy was a jerk. Not at all. I, you know, if he didn't have the time to get back to me, there was a reason for it, okay? It could have just been, you know, just not, maybe he didn't feel I was ready enough, or maybe he just didn't even read it, didn't have time to read it. And I know I can relate, because I have days, I have months like that. So, so look, it's just, you know, it's just a case of finding opportunities and making the most of them, and this takes decades, okay? See, this is my short answer to your question. What can I do as a 22-year-old autodidact 21st century composer trying to get some performances and maybe even recordings? Survive. Survive, Connor. That's what you've got to do. You've got to stick with it, and it's going to be rough. It was really rough for me. But the one thing that I never, ever even thought about was giving up, okay? And that's probably why I'm here. But, you know, keep in mind, there are some other people who are pretty tenacious too who have not ended up with the same opportunities. So, it, you know, you just have got to try your best. I read somewhere in, you know, some odd collection of facts that the, you know, the average number of resumes that a major job announcement receives is like over 1,500. for every one person who's hired. And, you know, I mean, that tells you something. It's certainly no different here in the arts. In fact, I mean, I almost feel like people who really care and are dedicated and come up to a professional level might have better opportunities than that when it comes down to it. So, and you know, and this world is changing too. You know, we don't know what it's going to be like. Will the El Sistema program that is started from Venezuela and is now going into communities all over Europe and Australasia here and the United States and other places, will that create gradually create a generation of people who are more interested in concert music again and see a revitalization of the orchestra? I don't know. You know, I mean, we could be the last generation of orchestrators, or we could be the first great generation of internet orchestrators. I don't know. Okay, so look, just survive, okay? Stick with it. That's what I got to say about it. Now, let's watch the second half of that tip and see which instruments can play niente, which I'm sure you've all guessed. But the reasons for it are really important. And one of the things that you're going to see about these tips, my tip style, is I try to not only tell you why I think this is the way it is, but I'm also trying to give you a little bit of ammunition should you get into a major fight over the internet about it. You could say, instead of just saying, well, I heard such and such, you could say, well, isn't XYZ the case? You know, somebody told me about it and I listened to some music and that's what it sounded like to me. Or I used this advice that I got in my orchestrations and it worked. So anyway, with that, part two of tip one.
Before we took a break in our tip about niente playing, I'd illustrated that the effect was functionally impossible for both double reed and brass instruments. Strings are a different story, though. The action of the bow across the strings can be quite subtle, and create a tone that barely vibrates in and out of audibility. There are, of course, practical hazards to this kind of playing, as the player's risk of unintentionally exciting a harmonic note increases as the pressure decreases. But a good player should manage this for the most part. It's worth pointing out here that mutes make no difference. The string players can dwindle down to invisibility with or without them. This is true for all orchestral instruments that use mutes. They're really more for tonal adjustment than volume control. But let's talk about the instrument that's truly the master of niente, the clarinet. Any subtle effect of microvolume can be achieved by an accomplished player in the lower register, including the very ethereal subtones, notes which barely seem there and yet insinuate themselves psychologically into a very fine texture. The reasons for this flexibility are once again built right into the instrument itself. As the upper section of the clarinet mouthpiece, called the beak, is a rigid surface, airflow can excite a barely audible tone, seeming for all intents and purposes without an attack. This can fade in and out with ease, allowing the composer to make use of the effect in many ways. Of course, there's a natural upper limit to niente on the clarinet. As the pitch rises above the Chalumeau register, greater and greater force is required to manipulate overtones with the embouchure, hence a greater need for clear, incisive tonguing by the player. There's a similar situation with flute playing. In the first octave, the flute is playing the fundamental of its scale. Since tone production on the flute is one of the simplest of all instruments, the splitting of an air passage over an opening in a chamber, the lower tones can be easily faded in and out with breath control, or even just slightly rotating the instrument. And yet, as the notes climb higher, more precision and force may be required to correctly reach a specific pitch. All manner of soft, subtle effects may be available with overtones, but they probably won't be a true niente. One last thing is worth discussing, and that is the time element. For any orchestral player, a quick niente attack or release is pretty much indistinguishable from any sudden crescendo attack or shaped release. There's really no point in scoring it, unless you want to test the exact degree of scornful looks you can elicit from an orchestra. No, it's an effect that requires time in order for the player to accomplish and the listener to process. It's a very special effect, worthy of respect, but only if you treat it that way in your scoring.
Hi, so back again after that tip. It's actually getting a little bit brighter outside. Yeah, it's I think when I started recording sort of in the 5 a.m. range, now it's past 6 a.m. And I'm trying to get this done before the house wakes up. And I have to actually have a pretty loud voice, but some very solid sleepers. So let's talk about tips, okay? As most of you probably know, from me saturating the Facebook page and making videos on YouTube and so on and so forth and tweeting. Yes, I am in the process of launching a book about tips, 100 orchestration tips. And part of this video is going to talk about that. I didn't want it to all be about that, but I do want to touch on it because we are in the last, I guess by the time this video is released, it'll be like the last 60 hours of the Kickstart. So the way that I'm doing this is I'm bringing the community together around these resources that have benefited them, and what I'm offering is a chance to consolidate those resources. So they are in a form that you can use as reference, that you can use to build your craft, and you can use as something that takes you farther than the orchestration manuals. Okay, so orchestration manuals discuss the basics, you know, how do the instruments work? And some of the better ones, like Sam Adler here, and just a couple of chapters in the Walter Piston. Hang on, try to get that to reflect correctly. In Walter Piston's orchestration, actually talk about orchestral arrangement and orchestration. But I want to bring together these tips that I've been presenting on Facebook and on the Orchestration Online website into one cohesive volume that sort of avoids the outsider's mentality, okay? Which is basically, here are the instruments, and we are going to do something with them. I think that that attitude is the source of faulty orchestration. I think you have to think better than that. You have to think like this. You have to say, you know, here is the orchestra. What do they do well? How can that thing that they do well be improved? How can we take the strengths of that group and exalt it? You know, how can we push them past their comfort zone in a way that gets them behind the music? What do they feel like when they take on something? And how is that important to the music? How important is that to the attitude of the music and how it'll be performed? You know, what are the nuances? What are the realities? You know what I mean? Because a lot of times, even Adler doesn't really talk about the realities of asking something. You know, he might say, well, this is a little bit difficult on the performer. What he doesn't tell you is that, you know, is that if the performer gets asked to do that too many times, you know, like you ask your first horn player to do a bunch of high Cs, and then right after that you ask them to play this beautiful solo, well, what do you think it's going to sound like? You know, knowing that kind of information is what makes you really strong in your craft, and that is what I've been trying to do or trying to teach. With the Orchestration Online website and resources and channel and everything else, the Facebook group, I've been trying to teach people how it works. You know, what is the architecture? What is the machinery? What is the interrelationships between the players? You know, how does it work in a practical way, and how can you subvert it? You know what I mean? In a way that's intelligent. So why is that? I mean, isn't that something that you should know? So a few years ago, I had this notion. I wanted to write a book called, you know, What Orchestral Musicians Know. And it was going to be targeted at the young composer. And here's a funny story. I have served as a mentor to the Composers Association of New Zealand, which is also known as CANS. We have a lot of NZ acronyms here in New Zealand. CANS, Young Composers Workshop. And talking to some of the orchestral musicians who went down there to play some of the student works was very illuminating. Something that the orchestral musicians would say was that when they did demos of their instruments, you know, they would sit down for an hour and they would play things that were difficult, things that were easy, and demonstrate how their instrument worked. And a lot of times they would say things like, this is an extended technique that is actually very, very hard on us players. And they would play the extended technique and then they would say, you know, please don't score this. Or they would say, don't score this that often because it just really hurts my lips, or it just, like, it really destroys my embouchure, or you know, it makes things difficult for me later on in the piece. And what they would notice is that the students would be earnestly scribbling this down, not as something to avoid, but they would be thinking, wow, what a great technique! I can't wait to use that in my next piece! So, the risks of writing a book like I planned, you know, like what orchestra players know, is that it would turn into a bunch of rants by the orchestra players, illustrating a series of techniques and do's and don'ts that, of course, naturally, the average young composer would find irresistible. And I know, because I was that young composer once, and, you know, I heard just the most excruciating things that would have been, you know, amazing to put into one of my pieces. And thank goodness that I didn't. So let's talk about the actual book, shall we? It's going to be organized a bit like an orchestra is organized. It's going to talk about the different sections in order. So you'll get a series of tips on how the wind section works, followed by individual tips about the instruments themselves and any particular auxiliaries that are relevant. Then it'll go on to the brass section, same exact structure. It'll discuss the percussion section, which is something that I have not really gotten a chance to do very much yet, but I have lots of really great percussion tips I want to share with you. And then, of course, it'll move on to special guests of the orchestra, like celesta, harp, and keyboards, and so on. And then, of course, eventually settle at the bottom of the score page with the string section. I'll also be giving you some tips about conductors and, you know, the way that they think, what they expect to see on a page. Is that something that you're going to find in an orchestration manual? Where does it say in piston what the conductor expects to see? How is he going to use your score? How is he going to mark it? What are the kinds of challenges he is going to run into when he's interpreting your music for the first time? Is that in here anywhere? Okay, I'd like to discuss that in detail. Something else you should know about this book is that that a lot of my friends who are orchestra players are quite interested in it and are going to be looking over my work and checking it for me. not that I think that that's all that essential for me, but I think that it's important for you in terms of credibility to know that what you read in the book and what you might be involved in, like, a, you know, a 30,000 word argument underneath a YouTube video, it's important for you to know that this information is backed up by a real player. A real player looked at it and said, yeah, that's pretty much the way we do things. Anyhow, so I'm going to talk a little bit about how the campaign is going. As I pointed out, by the time this video is released, there will be 60 hours left within which the community can support the release of this book, the 100 Orchestration Tips. So we're going to revisit that topic after this next tip. And I hope you enjoy it. This was really fun. This was one of the tips that made it through my technical incompetence as a video broadcaster on YouTube. So anyways, hope you enjoy it. Here it is.
Now for a shorter tip about brass registers and overtones, or really overtones of overtones. To review briefly, any note played by an orchestral brass instrument is essentially a position of the harmonic series blowing through a tube. This harmonic series is changed to a different range of pitches through the use of valves or pistons opening or closing extra sections of tubing, along with differences in lip pressure. Well and good. But I find that orchestrators often fail to fully absorb the implications of this system, and what the natural structure of each instrument lends to its particular sound. It's a grave mistake to fall into the thinking that brass instruments are all essentially the same, with little variations of tone or range. This is about as wrong can get. The coloristic behavior of the harmonic series is different for each instrument, a distinction that lies in each instrument's individual construction and technique. This discussion could easily cover hours of lecturing, but I don't want to spoil the party. So here's a quick thumbnail of brass instrument construction and how it affects range and register. The tuba is the most different of all the instruments, as it is both a whole tube instrument and it has a conical bore which runs nearly its entire length. As a whole tube instrument, it is built to sound its fundamental tones with much more ease than most other brass, and its bore gives those notes a certain wideness of tone and solidity. It also means that the range of most tubas is quite extensive, and fairly even in tone throughout. Some players can easily play very high overtones, making the tuba into a kind of clarino instrument. It must be said, though, that orchestrally these super high tones are pretty hard on the average player, and are difficult to work into most textures. Next stop, the horn. This instrument is often mistaken to be a whole tube instrument because its bore seems to be so wide and flaring. But in actuality, it's a half-tube instrument designed for greater clarity of tone from the second partial upwards. Fundamental tones are really only playable from the B-flat side of a double horn, and have a limited range of effectiveness. The truly distinctive characteristics of the horn start from the second or third partial, and intensify from there as the pitch rises through the harmonic series. Unlike its cousins in the heavy brass, the particular focus of intonation and tension of embouchure in the horn means that this is one instrument that can't play screaming notes written above high C. Unless they're trying to psych each other out at auditions, I mean. I've saved trombone and trumpet for last because of the odd notion that these two instruments are essentially the same thing in lower and higher versions. No, that's not true at all, but it's got nothing to do with slides versus pistons and everything to do with bore width ratios. The trombone is a whole tube instrument with a bore width that's intended to favor lower positions in the harmonic series. For the standard tenor trombone, the fundamentals sitting in the first few slide positions are all playable, if a bit flabby, and the F trigger makes this region more secure. The bass trombone is essentially the same thing, but its bore width ratio is even wider, allowing its fundamentals to speak much more clearly. The addition of an E or D key extend the bass trombone's range even further down with better clarity. The whole tubedness of the trombone means that its upper register is going to behave differently than the trumpet's, and its mostly cylindrical bore means that its notes will never be mistaken for that of a tuba. The overtones of the higher notes have a lower ceiling than those of the trumpet, and yet they're far more penetrating and smoky than a tuba. This is what gives the trombone its unique tenor voice, dense and crashing, or subtle and menacing, or even calm and eloquent. The trumpet, on the other hand, is the very definition of a half-tube instrument. Its fundamentals are a bad joke. From there, though, the trumpet gets stronger and ever more penetrating in tone until it can really scream up to high C and beyond. Here's the thing about those high notes, though, for both horn and trumpet. The actual basic tone at the bottom of each note's spectrum is not really that high. What makes those notes scream are their overtones. Any note on brass contains a large number of overtones, giving each instrument their character, dictated as we've seen by their construction. In the case of trumpet and horn, though, these overtones have a lot of weight. As the player ascends, these tones get tighter and more piercing. That is why so many great orchestrators have thrilling trumpet and horn parts that rarely scale the heights. Instead, they use those overtones to their best advantage for what they suggest, and build many compelling textures and solos around them. Overtones will feature pretty heavily in our last tip for this party. A little bit of fun for orchestrators who like to trawl the depths.
All right, I hope you enjoyed that tip. That one was really fun. I just really am fascinated by the mechanics of tone production. And that's something that I'm going to talk about a lot in my upcoming Mac Pro Video Orchestration 102 WINS course. So anyhow, so now we get to the nitty-gritty, and that is the orchestration book that I'm creating, the 100 orchestration tips, just to talk about, you know, this is me just sending out, you know, one last request to the community. And of course, you know, since this is a fundraiser, we've got the tote bag, we've got the t-shirt, we've got the coffee cup, we've got your orchestration calendar. I'm just kidding. You know, no, of course, I'm not offering any of that stuff. Actually, if you look at the 100 Orchestration Tips Indiegogo page, you'll see that basically the donation level that we start with is, you know, reserve a copy of the book. That is going to help me write it. That is going to help me postpone or put off work that, you know, otherwise I'll be creating another couple hours of orchestration instead of doing this for you guys. Okay, I would really like to be able to set aside that time. I would really like to be able to build up more resources for the Orchestration Online community. I would like to be able to help us, you know, develop our server a little bit so that there's more room on it, you know, to pay for its upkeep. I would like to have more stuff available so that I can make more sophisticated videos for you guys. Those donations are going to help that immensely, okay? But the main thing is just being able to, you know, to just set aside the time for just specifically for you guys so that you can become better orchestrators with a keener sense of craft. You know, that is why we are here. So if you look at the Indiegogo page, you'll see that that is how I've structured things. The perks that we're offering are, you know, they're really targeted at things that will make you better. Okay, like I've already released a video and discussed the five orchestral textures, where I get into the anatomy of different scores from film and concert music. That's one of the perks. I'm offering some instruction, some feedback that will take your scores and analyze them in a professional way. If you've got a colleague who is important to you and, you know, maybe a collaborator or maybe somebody that, you know, that their success as an orchestrator means a lot to you personally, we've got that gift option. If you want to get a copy for yourself and a copy for your friend. And of course, we've got this new website option, which I'm pretty excited about. Somebody has already picked up one since we announced it yesterday, where Sam Heyman, who is the web designer for Orchestration Online and just a really great guy and, you know, great sense of aesthetics and you know, speaking of craft, great sense of craft in developing web design. You know, he has offered to help us meet our goal by creating web pages and social integration and also managing sites for people who need them for their career as breakout orchestrators and composers. And I think that's a pretty good deal myself. So, you know, those are things that we're offering on the site that, you know, all together It will help you when you make your donation. You know, that's the main thing. It's all about building your career. It's, you know, it's not about coffee cups. Okay. Actually, I would like to make an Orchestration Online coffee cup, but if I do, it'll have like really incredibly important information on it that you need to use all the time, like maybe orchestra ranges or some other kind of some other kind of trivia that's really, really important for us working composers. So once again, focus on what's needed. Now, here are a few little previews of what the book is going to look like. We're still developing this design, so we may be closing some spaces, we may be changing the way that we do the graphics. There are a few images in here that are screen caps that have been adjusted so that they work with the page. I think that we are going to try to focus on, rather than having as many screen caps that are, you know, quite so so aged looking, which actually kind of look kind of fun, but I'd rather have screen caps that were basically taken from Sibelius, where things are very clean and easy to read, and that once more is going to take a little bit of time, but that's where you come in. You know, your donation is going to help me find that time and put it to good use. Now, a few more questions before we wrap things up and I show you the last tip. Okay, so here is a question that was from Dallas Crane, which is related to the tip that's coming up. I guess he'd watched the tip that, you know, in my abortive broadcast back on Sunday and had a question that was related to it. As you'll hear in this upcoming tip, I discuss the fact that the overtones from double reed instruments are actually pretty complex, and there are a lot of really, really high ones above the fundamental, which make the double reed instruments really good partners for instruments that just naturally have a higher type of sound. So, for instance, oboes work really, really well with piccolo, as you'll see. And, of course, bassoons work really, really well with flutes. That is a relationship that goes all the way back to the classical era, when dependable bassoons and really well-made flutes were starting to be made, and then orchestrators like Mozart and Haydn noticed, you know, the tonal relationship and exploited it. So those are some things that you should watch. Is, you know, they actually like to do things like having the bassoon and the flute track each other in octaves, which makes a really amazing sound. It just, you know, it makes the flute sound kind of woody and kind of intense and kind of punky. It also lightens the character of the bassoon. So anyway, Dallas asks, what other instrumental combinations play off the upper harmonics of lower instruments? Well, I would say one instrument you should check out is the horn, because the horn has also got really complex overtones. Horns match up really, really well with flutes, but you have to be careful that you don't overstress this relationship, because you can end up with some kind of piercing, kind of slightly unpleasant sounds if you overdo it. Horns have a natural tendency to push some of those higher harmonics, which is one of the reasons why, you know, you don't need to go above concert F or written high C on a horn. I mean, you just don't need to go there, because the horn tone contains within it those overtones that just really feel higher. I mean, it feels higher than it really is. You can score everything down an octave. I mean, it's just sort of like we were talking about in the last tip. You can score everything down an octave from where you think and still have a really beautiful, effective line. In this case, I would say, an octave higher or an octave and a fifth higher. You could try having string harmonics, with horns in the below them, or even just a single horn line, or like footballs in the horn part, and over that have it, try different things with string harmonics and, as I said before, flutes. There are some relationships there that are not as strong, though. I find that putting horns in octaves underneath oboes, just as that has never quite appealed to me. But, I mean, it might be a good, like, shock tactic. But I feel that those two tones don't necessarily complement each other the best in that, you know, in that intervallic relationship, you know, being an octave apart, you know, with the horns underneath. Some other instruments where there are there's the insinuation of you know, higher overtones. I would say the harp. If you can score lower on the harp in a very lush way, those strings, since they're so long, they contain a lot of those overtones in them, and the sound of them, if you really listen, if you pluck a deep harp string, you know, say anything below middle C, or C below middle C and below, and if you pluck it and you listen to what is actually happening as that string works its way through its vibration cycle, you will hear a lot of overtones there. And some of them, you know, that's why flute works so well with harp. That's one of those relationships that is just in there. And I've actually found other instruments work really well with harp too. I once composed something that had English horn and flute and string quartet and harp. So, you know, that was a really cool relationship. So those are just a few off the top of my head. When I write my book on texture, balance, and function, I discuss this a lot more. Anyways, next question. So this is also a question like Dallas's, which is related to the broadcast back on Sunday that didn't go through. And this is by Philippe. And he asks, I'd like you to talk about the relationship of orchestration and harmony, for instance, regarding tone color. You can also talk about the relationship of dynamics and tone color. Well, okay. I guess I could just go write a book. I could probably spend about like maybe 100,000 words on that. Or we could just, you know, a lot of those things could be in this book that's coming up. That is a huge topic. And once again, one of those things that you don't really find in the orchestration manuals. I mean, they sort of touch on it a little bit, but they don't explore that enormous significance. For instance, in Piston's orchestration book, he talks about how you shouldn't undertake orchestration until you've had like a good, thorough education in harmony and counterpoint, his other two books. So I imagine in his case, he probably would have students learn about harmony, and as they started to grasp the harmony, he would hit them with counterpoint. And as they were sort of chugging along with these two topics and were starting to master them, then he'd allow them to get involved with orchestration. My personal take on that type of training is that what is the most effective type of education is the kind that inspires the student to move forward quickly and to involve themselves creatively and inspirationally in what they're doing. So, you know, if you really want to be an orchestrator or an orchestral composer, I mean, there's no sense putting that off. So the best way to do it is to incorporate those topics into a course of study. So that at least you're familiar with it. Like, so if you're going to study counterpoint, you should study it alongside, you know, string quartet scoring and so on. If, you know, if you're studying harmony, you could study the harmony as it applies to orchestration. But that sort of is avoiding Philippe's question, which is, you know, the relationships and so on and so forth. I'll say just a couple of words about it, okay? And that is, speaking of overtones, is that one of the things an orchestrator needs to learn is what happens to those overtones, or essentially the tone of the instrument. What happens there when the instrument increases or decreases dynamically, okay? What overtones become strengthened? Because actually, you know, like for bassoon, for instance, you know, we'll be discussing contrabassoon in a second, but for bassoon, if you push a bassoon note, you start to hear different colors, okay? And, I mean, the same thing, of course, is true with a trombone. If you're a trombonist, you start to hear different parts of that, you know, of those overtones kind of sitting over your basic tone if you start to crank it. Or, you know, if you're at mezzo forte all the time and then you start to play quietly, you notice a reduction in certain of those. And that's a life study, you know. But you should just be aware that the resonance of instruments changes as, you know, as they increase or decrease dynamically. So yeah, that is something to know. And that is why to go into something that another person posted on Facebook, they were kind of pointing out that that dynamic markings were not volume control settings. And of course, that's something that I brought up long ago in my YouTube video course. And that is just, that you can't treat the orchestra like a mixing board. Okay? But what you can do, looking at those dynamic markings, is infer a certain type of harmonic resonance from those instruments, depending on what the marking is, right? So that is, once again, how do we get there? Rather than asking me that question, which I'm happy to answer, but how can you answer it yourself? Okay, so now let's go on to the last tip. And once again, I want to express my appreciation really deeply and honestly to everybody who is a member of the Orchestration Online community, whether it's Twitter or Facebook or YouTube. You guys have really, you guys have really been a great bunch of people to hang out with and to talk to, and you've been very supportive when times have been difficult for me, and you are supporting me right now for what I would like to do next year, which is a way of once again giving it back to you. Okay? Imagine what it would be like, you know, forget about like whether there is a future for orchestral music or any of that other stuff. What would it be like if there were a couple of thousand, you know, really damn good orchestrators out there who had worked together and learned together and, you know, and really given it their all and you know, polished their craft and knew what they were talking about? You know, what if that community on the internet was seen as a resource for conductors, for orchestras, for arrangers, for arts organizations? Imagine that. I'll see you guys next year. Happy New Year, happy holidays.
This last tip is just for fun, and it's this simple question. Just what do you think you're hearing when you listen to a low note on contrabassoon? Let's start with a note that's not even the lowest you can go. How about E below the staff? That's a Sibelius 7 sound. Not completely realistic, but close enough for what we want. Yes, that's a profound note, all right, the same pitch as the lowest open string on a standard 4-string double bass. But what are we really hearing? That pitch? Or a mixture of things all thrown together that we expect to hear from a low note? Let's isolate that note at a different point of the spectrum. Let's hear what those high overtones really are. Up at 1600 to 2000 Hz, we can hear the 10th and 12th partials of that low E, essentially forming the top of an E major triad, a mere 3.5 octaves from the root. You can also hear a buzzing. That's the separation of the different wave peaks of this tone, which get further and further apart as you get lower. You can hear them quite well up here, though, because the overtones are a part of the function of the sound wave. Let's drop down a bit and see what's going on in the middle. You can hear the fifth, sixth, and most strongly the seventh partial in this tone. Here's the region of the Vivaldi effect, where a bass note, if played too loudly, can interfere with the intonation of a chord, turning it from major to minor in some cases. The contrabassoon is unlikely to do this, for reasons I'll go into in a minute. Let's hear what things sound like down an octave or so. The richness of the tone emanates. In fact, it's setting up its own overtones and probably overloading your speakers a bit, if not your ears. We can hear the strong relationship between the second and fifth partials here, which, if they hit a resonant sweet spot, results once again in the Vivaldi effect. But when taken as part of the entire spectrum, it's merely the heart of the tone, evened out by what's above and below it. What about the actual fundamental itself, though? What are we actually hearing at the very bottom of this complex tone? Did your ears expand a bit there? Not surprising, as we're exaggerating a very wide frequency, one that can push air around with enough projection. Interesting, though, that it's such a colorless place. The real character of the tone of the contrabassoon's notes lies across the spectrum, and not at their fundamental frequency. And that's true of all the double reed instruments. It's one of those reasons why the piccolo makes such a great companion to the oboes in a harmony, or the flute to the bassoons. There are bits and pieces of high frequencies floating around up there where we don't always think of them, but they're quite usable. So what's the lesson here? Simply that a contrabassoon is built to give color and richness to the bass in a texture, but the fullness of that color will actually be felt an octave higher than you think. Consider that when you're adding contra to your bottom end, especially when you take it as low as it can go.